3, 2, 1,
go. New music, just for our new special guest. Today, just for you. Woo! Hey. Fala, galera!
Bienvenidos, amigos.
So, guys, we are so happy to have our guest today. I have been admiring his work for a long time, since we used to fly like a 3DR solo drone, which is that time was like a sensation, but that drone is
it's pretty bad. I was pretty happy when I sold that to some poor person on Gumtree.
Mine is still here. Yeah. Just like to put like maybe in the museum and say, hey,
decoration.
One day I use that drone.
Good one.
So, guys, with you today, our special guest, Josh Abbott?
Abbott?
Abbott. Abbott. Yay!
Even more is better.
Well done.
So, Josh, thank you so much for coming here. I really appreciate you accept this invitation, and I couldn't be happier because, as I said for you, I've admired your work for a long time. I've been looking at your job and everything that you have done. Plus, I know that you also have like a professional background, and that's complements a little bit this drone area.
Yep.
So we're going to be talking about this, and I think and I hope all the audience, you'll be interested to see that or to listen about that, because it's really
a bit different for some of your listeners, but it's good. Thanks for having me. I was pretty stoked to get an invite. So
yeah,
cheers.
Thank you, man. The main idea of this podcast, when we create that, is just to inform people. And I was talking with you before. The other thing is to show to people that behind the scenes, behind the cameras, behind a drone, all the work that people are doing, there's always someone that's really talented and work a lot to make things happen, and during the night and editing everything. So that's the main thing why we create this podcast. So I want to show this side, which I think more and more people are forgetting that, right? They only look
the glossy Instagram stuff.
Exactly. They just look the pictures, everything, and forget that someone is there, right?
Yep. And I've listened to a couple of your podcasts and instantly related with some of your guests.
Oh, really?
Shared that same sentiment. So.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah,
you're doing well.
Thank you so much. That's a good feedback.
Yeah, it's relatable. So.
Which means, guys, stay tuned. Yep. Maybe you're going to learn something today.
Stuff. Yeah.
I have like 53, I said for you like 54, but I cut like 22.
Got time.
Plus you have like some questions at the end.
Yes.
Some people send a few questions that are
interesting. I still don't believe it, but we'll see.
You'll be good. So Josh, tell me about it, because of course, drone is something that caught my attention a long time ago, but looking or doing a research and try to understand who Josh is, it came to my knowledge that you are a marine scientist, right? What a marine science does?
So I call myself a environmental consultant in the marine industry. So I've worked for several consultancies since university, and we basically collect baseline data for clients. We collect real-time data, monitoring data. We advise the client on certain aspects of their project in terms of the environmental aspect. So it's pretty a multi-faceted role. Involves for me a fair bit of field work, a lot of reporting, a lot of meetings, that sort of thing. So it's different to marine research, whereas we've got a lot of the time a private client we're advising and helping them through their approval stage of their project. And that's basically what we do. As I said, in my earlier days, I spent a lot of time in the field on boats, underwater, collecting data. As you progress generally through the industry, you can obviously pick your path, but I've gone more down now the reporting route in the office, less field time due to the family and things like that. So, it's a great industry to get involved with. When I started, it was a bit up and down. You didn't know if I was going to get a job or not. And I'm glad I stuck with it because it's 16 years later, still going strong. Yeah.
Fantastic. Josh, when you say that you were in the field, and maybe it's my absence of knowledge, right? When you talk about marine, because when I think marine, it's more like whales, dolphins, fish, everything. But the way that you're saying, what do you do? It's a little bit different. Yeah. It's not related with animals. Yeah, so am I wrong?
My lecturer at uni, she was very clear at the start. One of them said, it's not all dolphins and
really
fish. And there's a lot of, yeah, that's the 5% of it, right? So there's a lot of,
is that right,
unseen stuff that's not so glamorous, diving in zero vis, dealing with sediments, yeah, all that stuff. I've done everything from scuba diving to installing instruments underwater, counting seagrass, like literally counting blades of seagrass in a quadrant.
Really?
For hours underwater. Pulling up dirty, stinky sediment, putting it in jars. So there's a whole range of work we do, but there's definitely some awesome days. I've had some fantastic days on the water.
Like really?
Dolphins, whales, all that. But yeah.
So you saw some dolphins.
Oh, yeah. It's just not it's not every day. It's not as they see in the brochure of the marine scientist.
And when you say like glamorous days and days that were like memorable, What was the one that you said, oh, that was the best day that I had doing this job that's not so glamorous, but
special. I've had a bunch over the 16 years. Probably more recently at O2 Marines. I've been at O2 for the last 6 years now.
Uh-huh.
And a bulk of our work is up north in the Pilbara. And as a part of our work, we've had to spend a lot of time out on remote islands camping. Just in untouched, pristine environment, really. It can be pretty rough and hot and windy and all that, but you can also get some gem days. And, yeah, I've spent quite a few nights camping on islands under the stars just done a nice day of field work and then you do it again. And so some of those trips are, like, unforgettable. And the way we plan it is, if there's any clients listening, I don't know, we work very hard.
They're not listening.
We work very hard and we do the job, and then we always factor in a bit of time to do our own thing at the end.
Uh-huh.
So it's the fun stuff, bit of fishing.
So, which means that you're still doing like field jobs, right?
Yeah.
What are the main thing that you do when you say like field jobs?
So a lot of the work we do at the moment is we're installing instrumentation in water, so we leave it in there for months, years at a time, collecting data.
Uh-huh.
Some of that data is sent wirelessly over satellite.
Really?
To the office, so we can monitor it live.
Where pretty much like straight away, you finish, you collect the data?
It sends packets of data every hour or whatever. Well, you can set it up that way.
Okay, that blew my mind now.
It's cool.
Okay, I know that's amazing, right? But we live in Australia, right?
Mm.
Everyone knows that internet here, it's not the best. And you mentioned for me that you were working Pilbara, everything up north, especially up north, and some location that you are, we know that there is nothing.
Yeah.
So how you guys deal with the data, how we can upload and stream these?
Some environments, some areas we struggle with, but most areas we're in, you can get a bit of 3G.
Okay.
And it will eventually send that packet of data through. It might not be every hour, but it'll catch up and send it in bulk, yeah.
So you guys not talking with Elon Musk?
No, not at the moment. He might be able to help us.
There's a promotion. We are not being, there is no sponsor for this, right?
No.
But Starlink?
Starlink is, there is a promotion, so you can sign up. But that could be, I'm joking, but that could be something maybe interesting for you guys, right? Do you have like a Starlink or not?
Yeah, I think we're always looking to new ways to push the boundaries and make things better for the client and more efficient, cheaper.
And what's the advantage for clients receive this data, like straight away from real time.
So, for example, if it's a dredging program and there's a plume in the water, we want to know what that plume's doing now, not 2 weeks ago, because you might have to act or change your dredge methods, for example, if the plume is not going the way we want it to go. It's going to impact corals or seagrass. You might have to halt dredging, and you need to know that pretty quick.
Dredging. Again, that's a new term for me, and I was doing like research. I say, oh my God, what's dredging? And especially for people that's listening this, can you explain a little bit for me what's dredging?
So dredging involves removing the sediment from the seabed to allow a big ship to come in. It's too shallow. So generally that's what it's for. It's to allow ship movements of vessels to come into shallow areas. So you have to basically create more room under the boat.
So that's why you're working like really hard sometimes there in Pilbara.
Yeah.
Because the port.
Yep. Ports and harbours we do a lot of work with. So all up and down the coast, yep.
So have said that, for example, you born here in Perth?
Yeah.
So
born and raised.
Born and raised here in Perth, so breed here. So our coast might be amazing. You might know almost all the place here around here, right?
Done most of the WA coast, yeah.
It's incredible. Yeah. All the places, everything.
Yep.
And when you have to do this kind of jobs, what is your concern? What is your care to not maybe affect the not only the marine population, but the land, or how we can deal with that?
Yeah, so we are, as a consultant, you're often caught in between. So you're, at heart, you're an environmentalist, care about the environment, but you're also working for a client who's trying to get a project approved.
Mm.
So you often get caught in the middle. But the way I see it, and not everyone sees it this way, but if we weren't there, industry would do what they want and just kick the door down and ruin the place. So there's consultants in place to help guide them the right way and, hey, don't do this, you've got to do it this way, and guide them. And at least, you know, having us there helps a little bit.
Fantastic. Yeah. So basically all the paperwork, all the studies, everything that they need to do about the land or the area, they do, and you guys go there. Just double check if everything's all right.
We have to help them. Their project has to be approved by regulators, and we have to help them get that way. And it's not a perfect world, but Australia is definitely a lot better than a lot of other countries.
Oh, really?
Environmental protection.
What do you mean?
Well, there's some countries that the rules are really lax, and industry can do what they want.
You're kidding me.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
So they can destroy everything and do whatever they want.
You know, it's getting better and better. But yeah, Australia's, I consider it pretty firm in terms of environmental approval.
We have like also to respect the Aboriginal people here.
Yep.
What do you guys have like a straight relationship with them as well?
Yeah, we often work with Aboriginal Indigenous groups to consult with them before work's undertaken. And we often actually have people come along, Aboriginals and Indigenous people come along with us on some of our work. And it's a process of first, it's like communication. You've got to communicate what the plan is. Is there going to be an issue? Sort that out. And then it's just about involvement, really. And generally it works really well, and get both sides of the party working and teaming up, and had some great trips with some local people, and get them out in the boat, and they teach us things, we teach them, and it's just fantastic.
Oh, amazing.
Really good.
So Josh, I know that you said that you started your career like 16 years ago, going to the field, everything. I believe that you did everything manually, do the measure and go there again and do again measurement and everything. And drone came.
Yeah. And the drone came pretty late to me. 2015, I had my hands on a 3DR solo.
Really? But it's not that long.
Yeah. What's that?
Well, it's 8 years ago.
Yeah, yeah. So it's not that long ago.
So when you have like a... Are you kidding me that you use 3DR to do like mapping?
No. So okay. Sorry, that was for fun. So
oh.
This, I should tell the story of how I got my first drone. So
we are here to listen.
Yeah, yeah. So I was at the end of a 3-year contract.
Uh-huh.
And I was done. I was over it. This was marine science related. 3 years of long days working in the city.
On the office.
I was done. Yeah.
Okay.
So I had planned for a year to go on a trip around Australia with my partner.
No way.
I'd set the Hilux up, rooftop tent, everything. Like the whole route was planned.
The black one?
Yeah, dark blue. Yeah.
Charcoal, oh, is dark blue? Charcoal. Oh, okay, cool. The windows look black.
Yeah. And I literally picked the phone up to resign and call my manager.
No.
And my mate who I was working with, he knew the plan. He was in on it. He helped me set the car up and everything. He looked at me and said, nah, hang up the phone. So I hung up. He's like, I just heard that the company will be giving out redundancies in the next 2 weeks. I was like, ah.
Oh, that's good.
So I was like, this could work well. So anyway, it turns out I did get made redundant and I got a bit of a paycheck to leave and I bought my drone with that paycheck.
Oh, lucky man.
So I was going to quit anyway, but so that worked out really well. And then 2 weeks later, we were in Uluru.
No way.
On our first few nights of our trip, yeah. And we were away for, I don't know, it's 3.5 months or something.
Are you kidding?
I first put the drone up. Like I packed it in the car and just started driving. And then I was like, I should probably get this thing out and see what I can do. And the reason I went for a 3DR was because I already had GoPros. So
I didn't have to pay
for that bit.
Makes sense.
So yeah.
And that time was really expensive, that drone, right?
Yeah.
I remember to put all together, we thought the GoPro was $3,500.
Yeah.
It was because you have to buy the drone plus the gimbal. Yeah. And
put a little lens on my GoPro, yeah.
Yes.
So yeah, it started off just basically really roughly documenting the trip around Oz.
Uh-huh.
As just video. I don't think I took one photo the whole time.
Just the video?
Yeah, so I didn't really know what I was doing, but I started stitching a few little videos together with music on our trip and just throwing them up on Facebook. And yeah, at that time, all my friends were like, oh, this is amazing. Like, no one had seen that sort of thing before.
Uh-huh.
And it really, took off. And people were really interested. And so I just kept doing it. And then...
Because that time it was new as well.
Yeah,
no one was doing that.
Yep. I didn't know what I was doing. So that's how that all started. And when I got home, I didn't have any work. So I quit this job or got resigned. So I kind of dived into it a little bit and just enjoyed it. And then people started slowly asking for prints and it just started evolving like that. And yeah, snowboard a little bit.
Uh-huh.
And then, yeah.
And you mentioned that the prints are doing well and you're still
selling prints. Yep.
That's great. I've
probably backed off the effort a little bit there just because of family and life's busy. But I still sell quite a few prints. I stock a few stores around Perth in some shopping centres. And yeah, it's like an online store and yeah, it's good. I really enjoy going to pick up the prints and seeing them because some of them you don't see for a long time, right? I shot some of these photos a long time ago.
And you still work with Alex?
Yep.
To print everything?
Yeah, shout out to Alex at Sunday Sunset.
Yeah, man, he's an amazing guy. Every time that, when I used to print as well, he used to, what do you need?
Yeah.
I can do that.
He really talked me, educated me through that whole...
Is that right?
I didn't know where to start. And he gave me heaps of sample prints and he's been real good to me. So
that's good.
I've been pumping business through him since 2000.
So you came from here, Sunday Sunsets prints. Alex.
On your Alex.
I remember you, Alex.
So
Josh, from TDR Solo, having an amazing time traveling. You chill out when you come back.
Yep.
How come did you think, what time you realized that the drone could potentially help you to do your job? Or maybe you start to do your job first as a scientist and after you say, oh, the drone can help my job to promote and to do something better.
So I had probably a year or so where I wasn't... working as a marine scientist after that trip, and I dove pretty heavily into traveling around WA and getting a lot of shots and getting the website ready and selling prints that way. Yep, print. Dove pretty hard in Instagram and the socials and trying to pump it and got into that whole game. And then got approached by some old university friends to come along and work at O2 Marine.
Oh, that's good.
So that started a year or so before. Uh-huh. So I think I was the third employee at the company.
Is that right?
And I kept this drone thing going on the side, and the boss was great. He knew what I was doing, so he let me do what I wanted. But it probably wasn't a year or two into O2 Marine that we started tweaking, like, hang on a second, the drone can be used for more than pretty pictures.
That came from then, or you?
That was from me. I was like, I've got my REOC, so I've got my qualification, so we can go out and earn money with the drone. And kind of evolved from taking video and stills for clients just of their project site to, oh, hang on, we can map vegetation, we can get vegetation health, and that's just started evolving from there. So we acquired a few drones, the multispectral, and it's just been learn as you go sort of thing, but it's and it's still, like, today there's, it's just untapped what you can do with drones now.
When you say inspection, what's the difference from those drones that you use for mapping than normal drones?
So the mapping one we use is, we've used a few different ones, but the base one that's pretty suitable for most projects is that's the Phantom 4 RTK. So the RTK is the little node on top, and it's basically a more accurate GPS system, and it can talk to a ground station.
Really?
So you get, you can get like centimeter level accuracy. So that's used for your, like, your 2D, 3D modeling and mapping. And then there's another unit, the Phantom 4 multispectral, which has got your six cameras in one that shoots simultaneously at different wavelengths. So different reflectances. So everything around us reflects a different light differently, and that's how we see things. But this camera can pick that up and do basically like a calculation. And for example, a green tree will reflect differently, obviously, for a green leaf to a browning dead leaf, right?
You can see the health of the
health of the plant, right? Yeah, and if you do that over a large area like a mangrove up north, you can monitor the health of that system over time.
That's amazing.
And you compare to how we used to do that, or people still do it, I still do it, by foot, trudging into the mangroves. It's, yeah.
That's
to say, drones a lot easier.
You can say, I've been there.
Yeah. Yep.
So, I don't do this anymore.
Yeah, it's, and that's just one example of how drones can make things safer, quicker, and cheaper.
Fantastic.
And you can get some more outputs too, right? So when we're trudging in the mangroves, writing our nodes, we don't come away with a nice top-down aerial photo of, you know, you're limited with your data. So you can get more outputs in one by using the drone. You get this health data, you can get an orthomosaic, you can get terrain model.
Okay.
Yeah, and the client can use that.
So when you say the client, do you need to understand all these data? Because the way that you're saying, you collect a lot of data, right? Maybe through the photos, or there's something more.
Yeah, so in terms of the multispectral, the drone takes seven photos at once. So there's six. It's an RGB, like a coloured photo, and then five different wavelength bands. They're all different photos. You can layer them differently, and it's beyond me the maths how they do it, but there's a algorithm basically where you can subtract and minus wavelength bands to get those different reflectances. So yeah, there's a data processing component.
And are you responsible also to read these data and provide like a report to the customer?
Yeah, so we'll get back to the office, process the data. There's a software that does bulk of it.
Okay.
We've got a GIS team at O2 Marine,
so okay,
they can do mapping, all that stuff.
They understand.
Well. Yep. Yeah. And then we can get metrics out of the data. So They call it an NDVI. It's a health value, basically, of the plant. So that goes into a report. You include your photos, your text, and then you can monitor that area over time. Some uh-huh. clients, we're out there once a year for 5, 6, 7 years.
So, and all this information, everything that you collect, how you can maybe help the environment, or how we can say, guys, here we can do dredging, or here we cannot. What else you can do to help the environment on doing that? So if that's something that you guys do.
Yeah, so you can monitor issues that arise. You could determine if a mangrove stand is dying over time, and maybe that's due to a nearby construction.
Okay.
So you can link it. A lot of what we collect is baseline data too. So there's nothing there yet, but mm-hmm. there's planned to be an industrial uh-huh. Project. So a lot of that is identifying what's there naturally.
Okay.
So later you can compare. Yeah.
Josh, anyway, you are talking about all these projects that you're doing in Piura, and I know that you did something here on Elizabeth Key, right?
Yes.
And also here in Port Coogee, the mm-hmm. marina here. Mm-hmm. So tell me a little bit more, because the Elizabeth Key now, there are so many people that I don't know why they don't like, but in my point of view, I think it brought like life to Perth.
I think it was much needed, yeah.
And also, who knows here, Port Coogee.
Yeah.
The marina, it's beautiful, like all the house now that they can have. Tell me a little bit more, what kind of job that you did, how you work with that? And
marine science or drone?
I don't know. Tell me about it.
Marine science days, before Elizabeth Key was developed, I was involved in the baseline program. So we were diving in front of that river.
Are you kidding me?
Oh, yeah. That's the non-glamorous side of things. So, yeah, we were diving monthly in that river, collecting light data,
uh-huh.
zero vis. So I'm diving as close as me you are with my dive buddy, and we basically had to hold hands because we couldn't see. And you could hear each other giggling. Like it was.
Uh-huh.
So, that was, and it was freezing. It was like 13 degrees.
How about bull sharks?
Yeah, I didn't actually think about that then. I probably wouldn't do that now. Yeah. Because, I mean, you wouldn't know about it. You would know when it hit you because you couldn't see it. But
yeah, Jesus Christ.
So, yeah, that wasn't totally fun.
But I'm glad that you remember that.
Yeah. In Coogee Marina, I've been involved in that project since it was dirt
uh-huh.
at my first consultancy company. And, yeah, there was a range of work there. We're, again, diving in Coburn Sound. We're doing water testing, uh-huh. sediment testing. And then more lately, some drone video and imagery of the marina as it's been finished certain stages.
So
yeah,
when you did like Elizabeth Key, was just to check the area. So that area could be.
That was baseline data, yeah, to see what the river conditions were like prior to the development.
Uh-huh.
And then they've got that information. They know when they're developing, uh-huh. post development. You know, has anything changed? Has this development dramatically reduce the quality of the river? But
so you could be the one that say, hey, don't do anything here, Elizabeth Key.
That's above me. I had a wetsuit on, but the data, sure.
But Elizabeth Key, I remember when I arrived here in 2009 in Australia, right? And 2009, when I have like a picture from King's Park facing the city, there's nothing. Mm. There was just the big wheel there, which I think is, I don't know if it's the same.
I think it's in Freo, isn't it?
It is the same.
Yeah.
Cool. I remember that.
Pretty sure it's
over
the
there. And the bell tower opening there.
Got some sticked in it.
And there has nothing, right? I don't know how was Port Coogee before. It was in that way as well before you.
Yeah, I only know from reading like reports, but it was like from what I know, it was an old market garden. So the. there was a hill coming down to like the sand dune,
uh-huh.
and it was all market gardens, and there was a bit of industry around, so they had a lot of issues there with soil contamination.
Oh,
so
really?
They had to do a lot of remediation there, yeah, before, and they've actually installed, which is kind of cool, it's a trunk line underground,
uh-huh.
a pipe, so the groundwater comes down, goes into that pipe and gets so it doesn't go into the ocean, because the contaminants were leaking into the ocean, so they've bypassed it underground.
Is that because of the all the industries?
Yeah, the pesticides and the industry and the, you know, whatever they used on their market gardens. Yeah. Mm. So it's all good now. But if you go to that little beach in the marina there, which is really nice, mm-hmm. you can see there's some fresh water leaching, and the seagulls love it. They sit there and drink it on the sand, and that's from groundwater flow, and it's the leftover.
Jesus.
So yeah.
I didn't know about that.
That's pretty interesting.
You see, I told you someone is going to learn something today. Yeah, I learned something.
There you go. Yep.
And Josh, I know that all this technology you're using, I know that you are building a new team as well. We can talk about this if you want to or not.
Yeah, sure.
But do you see, like, especially with the advances on technology, when you talk about artificial intelligence, is that something that is affecting your job directly? Do you think it's something that's going to change a few things that you guys are doing now?
In drone technology?
Yeah, I think it's inevitably AI is affecting us everywhere.
Yeah. Yes, I'm sure it will. I think we've seen a little bit in the marine science area already with divers. So years ago, a lot of the data we got was through divers. Divers are being used less and less now because of the safety risk, and we're sending down instruments, cameras, ROVs underwater to do that work. So that's coming into play already. A lot of the ports and harbours, if they can avoid using divers, will, because it's just a safety risk that they don't want to take. So it's already changing. And then in terms of the drone, yeah, even in the 3 years or 4 years we've been doing it, things are getting smaller, cheaper. The cameras are getting crazy good now. So we're just about to probably purchase the Mavic 3 multispectral, just because the RGB camera's gone from 5 megapixel to 20, where it should be, right?
It's unbelievable.
But they've crammed all that now into a small camera. So, yeah, and it's just going to keep changing. So
maybe put your iPhones.
Yeah, strap it on. Yeah.
Put some propellers, put up.
I've got to keep going to the boss. Hey, can I get the new one now? Because the other one's already redundant. So, yeah, that's the challenge there. But, yeah, I mean, but, yeah, it's affecting, I reckon, in a good way. So things are getting safer and data's getting better. Yeah, it's pretty cool.
And Josh, the other thing you mentioned like a lot when you talk about your work and your family now, right? And you have a beautiful family.
Yep.
You have like two kids?
Two girls, yeah.
Two girls?
Yeah. Magic.
What are their names?
Jari and Molly.
Oh, Jari and Molly.
Jari's 2.5, a bit more now, and Molly's 1 next week.
Oh, that's explained why you're full on.
Yeah, dude. I've got so many hats on at the moment. But yeah, no, that is definitely the highlight of my life.
I'm really interested when you say hats, right?
Yeah.
How you manage your personal life, work life.
Yep.
So how you can balance everything. What do you do?
Oh, it's a challenge. Yeah, it's hard. I've really tried to focus on my family, number one. You know, everything else just falls away otherwise. Yeah, I think I feel really glad that I'm aware of that, because I think some people go through their career and their family and they're so busy and they're not aware that they're missing things. I'm very aware of that. So, I've dropped a week at O2, so I don't work Fridays. I haven't done since Jari was born, and I don't think I'll go back to 5 days a week, to be honest. Like, it makes a huge change, just that one day.
But you don't work at all, or you just stay at home, work from home?
No, don't work.
Don't work? Yeah. Oh, amazing.
So I work 4 days a week. There's obviously the odd phone call and email that you have to answer, but that's swimming lesson day with Jari and afternoon with the girls. And it's just made a huge difference. Yeah, and I just don't feel the need or the financial need, basically, to go back to 5 days a week, unless something dramatically changes. But yeah, what you get back, just having that extra day is, it's huge. And it's not only the time you get back, you also feel a little bit more empowered, like, no, I'm not going to work 9 to 5. I'm going to do it my way. And you almost take back a little bit.
It's good to have the power.
Yeah, it's good. And obviously not everyone can do it. You know, we live in a world where things are expensive and all that stuff. But we're making it work at the moment.
That's great. Now I can understand why when we invite you to come here on Friday, you said no.
Yeah, it's normally like, everyone's like, well, you got the day off. I'm like, well, no, it's a day off from work, but
for my family,
yeah, more commitments, yeah.
That's incredible.
Yeah. So.
And do you do anything, for example, for your physically, like for your mind, for your...
Yeah, I try. I mean, I used to be very active. Since year 7 or 6, I played football, AFL.
Okay. Footy.
Up till a few years ago.
I'm just going to clarify this because when you say football...
Yeah, I'm sorry.
We have one Argentina, a Brazilian, you know.
Yeah, I apologize. That's why I said AFL. I was very active through my teens, 20s and early 30s.
Is there a specific position? Sorry, I don't know much about the AFL.
That I play?
Yeah.
I was generally in the midfield, so like running.
Oh, okay.
A big runner.
Grab the ball, run.
Run, yeah. I think the coach, for some reason, thought I was a better runner than I was. So he always put me out. Put me in the forward pocket where I can snap a goal. But, a lot of time on the wing and in the middle. And then, obviously creep up forward and get a goal whenever I could. But so that stopped a few years ago. Obviously the body was giving out a bit, getting a bit old. And
I don't know why, hey. Weird.
It's hard. It's a tough game to... play in your mid-30s. Thursday nights I do a fitness group with some mates, and it's awesome. It's like my little time. It's an hour and a half, and we just go down the park and, sweat it out. And it's more about the banter, really, but it's really good. I do that, and then normally run to work once a week or something like that.
And when you talk about, for example, everything that you do, I know that I believe, of course, that that you need to keep up with knowledge. You have to study a little bit. Is there anything that you need to, that you like to read, or do you like to listen?
In terms of developing,
it could be your personal development to help your business.
Yeah, I have to do a little bit for the. Environmental side of things, because policy changes, so I've got to do a little bit there. But in terms of drone, and just get online, like YouTube's amazing. I'm always just researching new equipment, but
change so fast, hey?
Oh, it's crazy.
It's hard for it looks like every time that you try to research something or find something, the more you learn.
Yep.
The less you know.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have the same feeling.
Yeah. It can be a bit overwhelming, but I generally stick with what I know and just try and improve slowly. And yeah.
So basically, YouTube is your main source to find new things or to learn things.
Yeah. Obviously, it's a starting place. And then if you lock into something, then you can go down somewhere else.
Is there anyone or any channel that you love to watch all the time and you think that could be good to share with us? And
not particularly, not off the top of my head. No, I'll get back to you. I can think of something. I'm a browser.
You browse it, whatever show up in your
phone. I spend a lot of time looking at music on YouTube. I always,
really?
If I'm looking at something technical, then I'm like, oh, what's that?
And then cool.
2 hours later, you...
But are you a musician by chance?
I'm not. I haven't got a musical bone in my body, unfortunately, but music's probably one of my top three like passions. I love music.
Really? What kind of music do you like most?
I'm like Oz rock. I'm pretty broad. Like
you love everything.
Yeah, but good solid. I like a live performer, right? Yeah, someone who can perform live normally gets me.
Recently we did a job for Tourism WA.
Yeah.
And we work together with the guys from Voyager. I don't know if you know them.
Yeah, I've heard of them.
That they're gonna be playing on the Eurovision. I don't know if it's the kind of the music that you like.
Yeah, mate.
But the song that they are gonna use to represent Australia there, that is it's still in my mind, man. I cannot stop just singing all the time and catching. And Franco doesn't like this anymore.
Going crazy on it. Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's cool.
I also found the...
Oh, there we go.
Voyager. Yeah, that's the problem for us to, like talking in Portuguese and in Spanish, it's really similar, but when you have to say some words here in English, it's sometimes completely different the intonation, everything. Because if you read, you're gonna say voyage.
Yep.
But for you guys, it's voyage, right?
Voyage, Aussie slang.
Okay, I have the questions here for you, Josh. Mm. Are you ready? What is your favorite place in the world to use the drone?
Easy. Esperance.
Esperance.
I think that's a pretty common answer for a West Australian droner. That place is unbelievable.
Okay, come on, Josh. You've been traveling a lot on WA, right? Esperance is a place that all us have been, and it's blew a mind of everyone that goes there. So it's easy to go there, easy to access, beautiful kangaroos, amazing like water, blue water, dolphins if you are lucky. Oh. What's the other one?
The other one, not too far away. I had a great experience at Golden Gate Beach near Albany.
Oh, really?
It's really hard to get to. You got a four-wheel drive.
I never heard about it.
Yeah. When I first found it, I wanted to keep it a secret, but I realized most people probably know about it. But just Google it. Yeah, it's unreal.
He kept it secret. Well, he kept it secret, but he posted everything on Instagram or Facebook.
Yeah, it's all up there. Because I'd never seen a drone photo of this place before.
Oh, really?
I'm not saying I was the first, but me and my partner Sarah stayed there the night in the rooftop tent and woke up in the morning. It was unbelievable. Like, what we saw was just fantastic.
Jeez. So. Do you have the car still set up the same way that you? Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that was amazing. I remember seeing that car. I said, oh my God, this guy.
I'm thinking about moving it on, but I don't know.
It's hard, eh?
I start crying when I think about it.
You should plan to go, because I probably will be hard to find accommodation to go up there in Calgary to watch the eclipse.
Yeah. Yeah, you I'm kind of bummed I'm missing that. That's soon, yeah?
Oh, it's 20th.
Yeah, I don't think I'm here, but yeah, that would be cool. Yeah, I've still got the car. It's awesome. And the little one, Jari's had a few nights with me up in the rooftop tent, just the two of us, and she loves it. So, it's really cool. It's set up for, a week at a time. You've got power, fridge, solar. It's awesome.
Everything.
Awesome.
We need to find, footage or something from this.
Oh, yeah. No,
yeah,
no.
Yeah.
He used to have some amazing videos, man. I would just to watch them and say, oh my.
Yeah.
Because I was pretty new.
I've had some great times.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that, I'll touch back on Esperance. So I think we jagged two of the best weeks of weather down there ever. It was blue sky, not a puff of wind for nearly 2 weeks. Yeah. It was unbelievable. And that's probably why, because I know it can blow bad down there.
No, I've been there. I don't know, 5-6 times. I don't remember how many times I've been there. There is no single day that's not windy there.
Yeah, crazy, huh?
Geez, so you were lucky.
Yeah, and we had I had a pretty cool experience. We were quite remote somewhere from Lucky Bay. I think we must have been east of Lucky Bay on a remote beach.
Uh-huh.
And just chilling out, and then all of a sudden this big Land Cruiser pulls, comes screaming up to us. Hadn't seen a car in hours, so I was like, what's going on? Three big dudes get out of the car, and I was like, oh, shit, what's going on here? And I see one of them running in the water, and he's holding something, and the other two standing on the shoreline, and I was like, what's going on? I went up and talked to him, and they're like, oh, can you go help him? He can't swim. I was like, what's he doing? He's like, oh, he's trying to release that dolphin, And I realized he was holding a baby dolphin about this big.
No.
And it had washed up on the beach.
Are you kidding?
It was alive. It was fully kicking.
Uh-huh.
And I said, oh, he just needs to put in. He said, well, he's scared and he can't swim. So he was standing in knee-deep water trying to push this dolphin, and the dolphin kept getting whacked by the waves.
Uh-huh.
So I ran out and I was like, can I help you? And he's like, yeah, just threw me this dolphin. And I'm holding this slippery, like it was only that big. It was one of the most amazing experiences of my life. I was like, oh, my God. I just wanted to hold it. I was like, I probably should help it. So I swam under waves with this thing till I couldn't stand anymore and just gave it a big shove. And
are you kidding?
Yeah, it was unbelievable.
That's like experience
that,
of your
like
life.
Topped off the aspirants sort of.
Oh, yeah. Man.
Yeah, unbelievable.
Only lucky people do that.
Yeah.
I have another question which say, what is the typical work day for a marine scientist?
Typical would be me in the Fremantle office. I love living in Hammy Hill, so I'm only a few minutes away, which is nice. Yeah, on the emails, writing some reports, looking at some data, probably two or three meetings during the day, and then probably getting some equipment ready in the warehouse, helping the young crews get ready for their field deployment, freighting gear up to Port Hedland or Karratha or Onslow, wherever we're working. I am a project manager now, so we've got a lot of really good young crew under us. So we're mentoring and we're help guiding them now. So yeah, that's part of my role. And then more recently, heading O2 in-flight. So it's a branch of O2 Marine, which is the drone section of the company. So I'm the manager of O2 in-flight. It's still very young and we're trying to drum up work. So yeah, that's part of my role.
So O2 in-flight imagery, is coincidence?
Poaching? The boss was like, what should we call it? And I was like, well, I already had a business called in-flight imagery. That's just, yeah, it goes well. O2 in-flight's good.
Yeah. Josh, using these, because you just touched base again on your typical day as a marine scientist. Let's say that people that are listening here, they love what you're saying, all the opportunities that you show to us. And I'm trying to, maybe that's something that we could think about it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
What could be the advice that you could give someone that's thinking and some opportunities, what they could do, where they could start, for example? Is there any place that they need to go to study? What would be the training or the course?
Yep. So you'll generally need a degree, an environmental science degree. Mine was 3 years at uni and then I did an extra year. So that's obviously a great start. But to be honest, getting your foot in the door, university or not, on a boat or just volunteering is, to me, by far the best thing you can do. We've had people come in off the street basically with a little bit of experience, or you know, I've worked on boats or I want to get into it. They come work for us for free and we do a bit of a trial run. Before you know it, they're on the books. And yeah, obviously if you're going to do technical marine science, you need a degree, but there's other roles where you don't need an actual degree. In my experience, just get in there, and once you're in there and people know you and they trust you, it's so much easier to employ you than going looking for someone else.
100%.
And you just got to show up. And I think I could probably count on, you know, two hands how many people work at O2 Marine have got work that way.
Really?
Come in as grads or volunteers. And before you know it, like, hang on, we need a decky on a boat next week in the Pilbara. Can you go? And they're like, sure can. And boom, they're on. And then that's how it starts.
Can I help you doing anything?
And it's, once you know someone, you can trust them and they already know a little bit of what they're doing, then, that to me, that's the best way to get involved. And you'll have to just volunteer your time and probably expect not to get paid for a little while. But,
that's such a good advice.
Yeah. And every job I've got, I've had three or four moves. I've got that job through someone I know. I've never done it. I've done one half job interview, but I already had the job because I knew the person who,
So network is the most thing At least the best thing that you can have
get
here.
Get out there and meet people and show you that you're keen. And
and how you keep it up with your network here in Perth?
There's the odd event we go to, but in terms of droning, it's always online. Like there used to be, I don't know if you remember that the crew we had online there for a while, and everyone was catching up. And that to me, I've stepped away from that a little bit because I've got other priorities. But online. We at Environment, there's always workshops and consultancy groups, and you go along lunch and learn sort of things like that. So yeah, that's how you. But the marine science industry in Perth is very small.
Is it really?
So yeah, very small. You know a lot of people in your competitors and in the clients, and I went to uni with you. It's very
everyone knows everyone.
So you got to be careful not to burn your bridges. Just be a nice person.
Which is hard sometimes. Hey, you cannot please everyone all the time,
that's
right?
It. Yep.
So yeah, it is as it is.
Yeah.
Franco, how are we? Anything else?
No.
Josh, thank you so much for coming here. I really appreciate.
No worries.
I said to everyone that you're gonna learn something. I learned a lot. Few things.
Yeah.
Few things that I have nothing and that never taught in my life. So thank you so much for sharing and all the amazing stories, especially when you talk about the Esperance. That was
gotta go back. Thank you so much for having me. It's awesome.
And thank you for sharing your secret place in WA.
What have I done?
Yeah. We're gonna be the second one to take photos with drones.
TripAdvisor next week will be like the best beaches in the world. You'll be
Be the title of the video. Yeah. The hiding place in WA.
They put like the Misery Beach there, right? I don't know.
It's nearby. Yeah.
But that beach is not that good. But anyway, it's not us.
I think honestly, there's so many beaches. It depends on the conditions. Like you could go to Misery Beach and it could be miserable,
really. Yeah,
depending on the weather, right?
That's true.
Whereas some other beaches, if the weather's right, it'd be amazing.
That's right.
To me, it's just time and air. You got to get out there more. Like that's what I found with droning, right? So many shots I nearly didn't get, but I just threw the drone up anyway, and the clouds parted, the sun came out, and you're like, boom, and you nearly were about to pack up and go home, you know?
Exactly.
Just got to get up there.
Cool.
Yeah.
So guys,
thank you.
If you like this podcast, leave a review,
subscribe,
share with your friends.
Subscribe.
Do whatever you think you want to do if that it's good for you. And see you next time. That's the new music just for you, Josh.
Thank you.
So, Josh, the other thing you always do, like, it's kind of a BTS.
Yeah.
Just show something what we did before.
Yeah.
Did you have opportunity to fly together? Oh, we never flew together, huh?
The drone?
Yeah. It was not you.
Only at the cancer ride.
Oh yeah, we worked there.
Mm.
And I worked for you as well on the museum.
Multiplex.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that
and then besides then, I think we bumped into each other once or twice, just free-flying.
What?
At Coogee. The beach down there, Coogee.
In Coogee, yeah.
Yeah.
Coogee, and one day I remember that I was flying Fremantle as well. You said, oh yeah, I'm here. So,
where? What happened? I will have to do more flying in the future.
But man, I think... The story that's funny is just this 3DR solo. I don't know if you have the same issues or same problem that me, but you could fly only 400 meters and that's it. The signal lost.
So many moments where I thought I'd lost that drone, just lost connection, and I'm like over a cliff, you know, Great Australian Bite, and you're just like, oh. And then all of a sudden it'll just come back and you're like, oh, I'm back on here.
Are you kidding?
Yeah, I'll just lose total connection and couldn't see it because it's like 100 meters down there.
Jeez. I'm gonna tell you a story that's not everyone that knows, right? But when we didn't have these regulations on City of Stirling that you cannot fly drones over there, I was flying with a friend that we just took our now we call REPL, right? Our drone certification as a pilot. So you went to fly there on Scarborough. We were close to the car park.
Yeah.
And I was flying the 3D. I was bringing back the drone. And my friend, did you see that you lost the drone? I said, no, I'm bringing back. How come? Yeah, check your drone. And the drone fall.
Oh, no.
Gone. It's pretty much like fall on the sky. And I couldn't find and didn't see where it was. Jeez. And luckily, I don't know if you remember, you could press the button on the controller. The camera could turn on and turn off. I think one of the last updates, you could turn on and turn off the GoPro.
Yeah.
And I start to turn on, turn off. And I start to listen the GoPro.
Oh, no
turn
way.
On, turn off. Turn on, turn
That's
off.
That's classic.
And I found the drone was on top of a bush there, close to the pathway, wow. Everything. I was, man, that time was...
And survived. Was that it?
After that, I have a really good relationship with the guys from 3DR.
Yeah.
So they send another drone for me. Nice. And they send another one. Huh. So I had two drones. And they send batteries, controller, everything. So
lucky you.
And even at the time that they have like this magazine, they put some shots that I did there.
Cool.
And yeah, the CEO, the CTO now, the guys that developed the product.
They're still going?
I don't think they're still going because they move it, right? They were consumer drones, and after they moved to be only commercial stuff, but even the guys that I met there, they are doing other stuff. They are really clever guys now.
Yeah, when I bought mine, it was the hot thing. The video they had was so like, oh yes, I need this.
Because when we bought that, they have the Phantom 2.
Yeah.
We have like this, it was shit stuff.
Yeah.
Plus you could put like the GoPro, but it was a Chinese and you have like a brand that comes from the US.
Yep.
The DJI was not that famous, and the guys from 3DR that was promising, they were promising, hey, you can buy the drone and you can pretty much customize the way that you want to go, you know, and say, that's the future. That's why I bought it. And I don't know if you know, I lost one on the first week.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Gosh.
I was flying beautiful shots. My friend was surfing. And to get good shots, you have to be closer, right?
Yeah.
And I was...
Looking
just to the screen, beautiful shots. The screen start to be black.
Oh dear.
And I look, where's the drone?
Turned into a scuba drone.
The drone, I wouldn't be able to see anymore, so.
Yeah, I had one turn into a rock on me. I was flying, I was shark spotting for a surfing event.
Uh-huh.
So they just had me going up and down the beach above the surfers or near the surfers to look for sharks. It was a school surfing event. That was an easy job. And then on my screen, this DJI, battery cell error, return home soon. And I was like, soon? I was like, how soon? So he's like, anyway, I started coming home and then all of a sudden... and just dropped into the drink, and it was a real rough day.
Oh.
And it was 50 odd meters out, and I was like, I'm not getting that back. And everyone on the beach saw it, and I was so embarrassed. I was just like, oh.
Oh boy.
And then I started worrying. I was like, I've got a job to do. I've got to get my backup. So I had the 3DR as my backup, and I hadn't turned it on in like a year. So I turned it on, and of course it needed an update. I was like, oh. So I was like, mucking around, and my mate came down luckily, just randomly, who also had a 3D, and he helped me get the upload going and got me in the air. And I went home that day and I was just like almost gonna cry. I was like, I've lost a drone, I nearly failed the job. And
jeez, man.
People saw it, and I was just like, oh, what a mess. DJI, I had a new drone, a new Phantom on my doorstep 2 weeks later. DJI, because you give them the little black box, you know, the flight record.
Oh, they saw that.
They saw what happened,
mistake.
And they realised it wasn't me. So, yeah, I had a brand new drone, which was nice.
Which now, like or not, DJI start to be the best one now. So
yeah.
It's just,
I feel like it's easy.
Those kids nowadays, they don't have idea how hard it was before.
What we went through. Yeah, that was a struggle.
Cool, Josh. Thank you so much. Awesome. See you guys.
Thank you.